Genre film has been the driving force of cinema since its inception. Audiences flock to genre films because of their consistent themes, predictable narratives, and the studio's continual output. And, in the history of genre film, no genre is more synonymous with America than the Western. Westerns represent some kind of American ideal: freedom, ruggedness, heroism, beauty, manifest destiny, and independence. This series is an attempt to tell a brief history of the genre, its ups and downs, and the many changes it underwent to get to the present day. And to start telling the story of the Western, there's no better place to start than 1903. In the early days of film, only one studio was toying with the idea of the Western. Edison Films, Thomas Edison's small film production outfit, made two Western-inspired shorts in 1899, Cripple Creek Barroom Scene and Poker at Dawson City. Both shorts showed scenes set in the Wild West and featured typical Western vignettes. However, it was not until 1903 that the first true example of a Western film emerged. The Great Train Robbery, directed by Edison cameraman Edwin S. Porter, told the story of a gang holding up a train and stealing all of its money. Although the film is short, finishing out at 10 minutes long, it holds almost every Western trope. A gang of black hat-wearing bandits violently board a train, stealing the money and riding away on horseback, only to be tracked down by a bunch of square dancers and ending in a climactic final shootout. The movie is not only one of the earliest Westerns, but also one of the earliest narrative films ever made. The director, Edwin S. Porter, developed several never-before-seen techniques like parallel editing and jump cuts to tell the story. But really, the most interesting shot in the film is one that left a mark on all of cinema. Porter filmed a close-up of a gunslinger pointing his gun at the camera and unloading all of the bullets directly into the viewer's eyes. Not only was this one of the first close-ups ever seen in the film world, but it was an unprecedented breaking of the fourth wall. Audiences were terrified by the bandit seemingly firing directly into the audience. The shot is responsible for not only setting the standard for a cowboy's appearance on screen, but also for inspiring the final scene of Goodfellas, where Joe Pesci replicates the famous shot, but also as a direct inspiration for the James Bond title sequence. After The Great Train Robbery became one of the highest-grossing films of the early silent era, the Western genre took off. Westerns became a staple of the cinema-going experience. American Biograph, one of the biggest studios at the time, produced several Westerns, many of which were directed by film pioneer D.W. Griffith. Griffith helped to further the genre, giving it its first-ever sequence of a raid on a wagon train in The Last Drop of Water, as well as its trademark racism towards American Indians. Another great director, Cecil B. DeMille, furthered the progress of the genre with the film The Squaw Man in 1914. The Squaw Man not only was the first feature film made entirely in Hollywood, but also gave birth to the racist depiction of American Indians that would become a staple in many of the classic Westerns. Still, though, the movie was so important and well-liked that DeMille remade it not once, but twice. But in the early days of film Westerns, no director is more important than John Ford. Ford, the brother of a well-known actor in the early days of silent cinema, made his first ever feature film, a Western called The Tornado, in 1917 when he was 22 years old. Ford was given the job by Universal Studios boss Carl Laemmle, who said, "Give Jack Ford the job, he yells good," beginning what was to be a long and successful career. Ford is said to have made more than 60 silent films between 1917 and 1928, making 10 films in his first year as director. But it was not until 1939 that he would make one of the greatest films of his career, and one of the best Westerns of all time, Stagecoach. Stagecoach tells the story of a group of strangers taking a stagecoach west while being pursued by a group of raiders led by Geronimo. The movie is stylish and well shot, and was John Ford's first ever sound Western. The movie is credited for reviving the Western genre after it had fallen out of favor in the 1930s, replaced by horror and adventure films. Stagecoach was fresh and exciting, with a climactic horse chase and vibrant characters. The film endures and holds a significant place in history of the Western because of its philosophy, though. It serves as a morality play of a new age in America, a populist film that defined a new American character. The Stagecoach carries three upper-class people along with three people who represent the dregs of society. However, the lower class are the heroes in the story, while the upper class are hypocrites and criminals. A high-class gambler, who is obsessed with manners, tries to seduce a married woman and treats his other passengers with disdain until he decides to use his last bullet on a new mother. A liquor salesman with a family is a fool and a coward, never trying to stick up for himself. A woman married to a military general is stuck up and snotty, refusing to sit next to the working class. And, most significant of the whole bunch, the owner of a bank sneaks away from his wife and steals all of the money from the bank, hoping to scam working people out of their jobs. In a great scene, this banker gives an emphatic speech about how the government is ruining this country by restricting industry and taxing the rich, showing his hatred of the common people and his desire to keep his wealth to himself. While Ford shows disdain for the upper class, he reveres the common people. John Wayne plays an escaped convict with strong moral standards who saves the day. A drunkard doctor who is kicked out of town for his alcoholism turns out to be the wisest and most intelligent member of the party. And finally, a prostitute named Dallas is shunned by all of the upper class, even after she saves the general's wife's life by delivering her child. Stagecoach's representation of the new moral code and the rejection of class distinctions is a landmark of the Western genre. In America's frontier, what mattered was a person's morals, not their status or wealth. The Western, in its early days, was a reflection of a new, populist age of American society. It was a celebration of its audience, the working people of America. Ford went on to become a legendary director in Hollywood, developing the Western genre into a new form of storytelling, a representation of America's developing modernity. But Stagecoach wasn't Ford's most important Western. That position was taken by another film in 1956. While Howard Hawks was making Westerns about archetypal Western heroes, John Huston was telling fables about greed, Fred Zinnemann was condemning McCarthyism, and George Stevens was heralding pacifism and order, John Ford took the Western into a new direction with his landmark film, The Searchers. Ford, a longtime master of the Western genre, had given up making Westerns in the 1950s. After serving in World War II as a filmmaker and seeing action in the Battle of Midway and the D-Day landings, something about the idealized hero of the West didn't sit well with Ford. Instead, he turned to making farcical send-ups of the Western and the war drama with films like What Price Glory? But, in 1956, he returned to Monument Valley once again to tell the tale of Ethan Edwards, a fighter for the Confederacy during the Civil War who returns home only to have his young niece kidnapped by Comanche raiders. Ethan immediately sets out with his adopted nephew Martin to find the girl. Ethan is not the typical cowboy hero, though. He is gruff, short-tempered, cruel, and above all, an extreme racist with a strong hatred of American Indians. Throughout their journey, Ethan is brought face to face with the modernization of the West. His nephew Martin is part Cherokee, and the West is beginning to look like an integrated place where everyone has a part in the future of the frontier, regardless of race or gender. Ford turns John Wayne's bright-eyed, moralistic hero into an outdated relic, a remnant of a past bearing a legacy of prejudice and failure. But it's not just the archetypal hero that John Ford tore apart with The Searchers. The notion of Western justice and glory is gone too, most powerfully illustrated by a comical fight that occurs after Martin returns home after 5 years to see that his sweetheart is betrothed to another man. Despite the horror and the treachery he's been through, Martin still participates in a comically chivalrous fight while all the townsfolk watch, demanding that the two fight fair. Ford also depicts the American military, the supposed keepers of the frontier, as cowards and villains, men who can either not handle a sword or who seem hell-bent on the extermination of the Comanche. The West is a dark place full of insanity and violence, no longer a symbol of American liberty. Ford ends the film with one of the most famous shots of all time. John Wayne's Ethan Edwards framed in a doorway, condemned to live the rest of his life in the dust of the plains, not welcome to be a part of society. With this conclusion, Ford seems to signal the death of the Western hero as a symbol of optimism and hope. America had turned down a different path, become more modern than the Western ever could for Ford. In the age of the atomic bomb, gunslingers and cowboys seemed foolishly idealistic. And so, the crimes of history and the hopefulness of the Old West, resting on John Wayne's shoulders, was shut out from the modern American society. The Western film fell out of favor at the end of the 50s. American audiences demanded more modern heroes. And in the 1960s, those heroes would be found abroad.